Wide World of Sports, where Fox Sports kicks off our coverage of Braves baseball here in 2017 as we host the Detroit Tigers. Hi again, friends. Great to be back with you. Chip Carey, Joe Simpson, partner. What a difference a year makes. 2017, a lot of optimism in Braves country.
To be honest with everybody, we weren't sure what we were going to be talking about last year. Things got off to kind of a rough start, but what a difference a year makes. There is a buzz about this team. Everybody's excited about the prospects of what this team might be able to do this year with the addition of several veterans scattered through the pitching staff on the infield. So even people outside of Atlanta are saying, we don't know what to make of this Atlanta Braves team. They may surprise a lot of people.
And it's a sight for sore eyes for Brian Snitker. He's got what could be his opening day lineup, with the exception of Jaime Garcia, who's the pitcher for Atlanta today on the WBC, wreaking havoc with Major League lineups. But the big guns are in the lineup, and we'll get our first look at the Braves and the Tigers right after this.
At Menards, home improvement means saving big, because right now you'll get an 11% rebate on everything in the store, including thousands of sale items. UltraDeck Rustic Low Maintenance Composite Decking has the look of wood without all the...
Presented by Landmark Dodge, Chrysler, Jeep, Ram.
A pretty but breezy night tonight here at Champion Stadium as the Braves take the field behind Jaime Garcia. We get our first look at Jaime here tonight as we face the Detroit Tigers. A look at the Braves' defensive lineup. And Joe, for the first time in about 3 weeks, Brian Snitker has what ostensibly will be his opening day lineup at his disposal tonight.
Whether it was the World Baseball Classic or injuries to the two guys on the left side of the diamond, they have not been able to put everybody on the field until tonight, since March 4th. So I know Brian Snitker's anxious to get those guys out there and let them play here in the last week of the season and get fine-tuned for the season opener.
So Jaime Garcia is the man on the mound, the former St. Louis Cardinal. And the way that the rotation's going to stack up, partner, against the New York Mets in the opening series, Jaime's going to get the ball in Game 3 against New York.
Well, he will be the only lefty in the rotation. He is 30 years old, 6'2", 195, out of Mission, Texas. Came over from the Cardinals, as you know, and uses two different fastballs, four-seamer, two-seamer, throws a nice cutter. He's got a curveball and a slider. When the Braves first acquired him, I went right to Adam Wainwright. And I asked him, I said, what did we get? What did the Braves get? And he said, you got a really good pitcher. And when this guy's healthy, and last year he had a good season with the Cardinals, so he's able to stay in the rotation. When he's healthy, he's as good as anybody in the National League.
We saw that last August, the 1-0 game that he pitched against the Braves, beat Atlanta, and drove in the game's only run. That's the kind of talent that Jaime Garcia does possess. And we'll see what he has in store against this Tiger lineup. No Miguel Cabrera tonight. He's back in Lakeland. Amber Romine leads off. They do have Victor Martinez, who lives here in Orlando in the offseason. Alex Avila's behind the plate. Jose Iglesias, a terrific shortstop. Ghost Machado and Perez in the bottom part of the order. For Brad Ausmus, whose Tigers last year missed the playoffs by a single game in the American League Central.
Yeah, they went 86-76. Had a good year, but not good enough. That three-game series in Atlanta proved very crucial to them.
So we're set to go. Glad you're with us. Our first of four spring telecasts for the Braves this season. And Jaime Garcia to work. Good crackling fastball. Jerry Lane, our old pal, behind the plate, calling balls and strikes. Andrew Romine, 109 games for the Tigers last year. Having a good spring this year. Batting 360. Dansby, nice stop. Scrambles and gets his man right on cue. Right, roll tape.
Dansby, who had missed a lot of time with a strained oblique muscle, makes a dazzling play to start this game.
Our first Dansby dandy of the year.
Yeah.
So Romine robbed. That's how the game gets underway. Garcia ground ball out. And here's Nick Castellanos, their terrific young third baseman. One problem, Joe, the Tigers had last year was injury. They had 10, 12 different, almost season-wrecking injuries to their ball club last year. And Castellanos is one of those guys that got hurt. He broke his hand late in the season and was available for just a handful of games in September. And many people in Detroit say, well, what if, with regards to their 2016 fortunes, what if they'd stayed healthy?
They're one of the teams out there, maybe the few teams, Chip, who can say, you know, we've got a good rotation. We've got solid guys in there up and down, including the guy going tonight, Justin Verlander. And they've got a really good lineup. It's just a matter of keeping them all on the field.
Castellanos has hit a couple of home runs this spring. And found the zone at the knees. Good pitch. Ball and two strikes. Castellanos just 25 years old. Terrific defensive third baseman, too. Only 9 errors last year. So, terrific player. That one well short of the plate. 2 balls, 2 strikes.
Garcia made 30 starts last year for St. Louis, 171 innings pitched, 150 strikeouts, 62-45 in his career.
Brandon Phillips playing Castellanos up the middle behind the second base bag is. He's ready with his 2-2 pitch. Nasty. And Castellanos down on strikes. 2 up, 2 down. And that'll bring up Victor Martinez. We'd like to say hi to our audience and welcome fans watching on Fox Sports Detroit. Tiger fans know all about what Brad Ausmus's club did last year. Hope our pals Rod Allen and Mario Mpemba are enjoying a night off in Lakeland tonight.
You see some really high offensive ranks, and they were 6th in the league in runs scored. Despite all of that good offensive output, they're not real athletic. They are a slow team. They don't run much. If there's anything that they could use, it's some athleticism. But boy, they can hit.
Victor Martinez knows all about that. 7th year with the Tigers now. He's 38. 27 homers, 86 driven in last year, only struck out 90 times. And in this day and age, that's certainly noteworthy. And he played, Joe, on bad knees all year last year. And that's, I guess, the other question mark for the Tigers this year, age and injury.
Well, there was some talk about the Tigers entertaining thoughts of doing what the Braves did, and that is make all of the veterans available, including Miguel Cabrera, for the right price, and try to rebuild this ball club. But it didn't happen. The additions they made, and you saw on that graphic, no eye-popping additions to really fortify this team. So whatever they were thinking didn't materialize, so they're going with what they had.
Well, with the Cleveland Indians and the injuries they've already racked up, Kipnis is out for 5 weeks. Cody Allen's out with a bad arm. Maybe they can make another run and dethrone the Indians in the AL Central. White Sox are rebuilding. Kansas City has had their issues, obviously.
Yeah.
So we'll see how it goes for the Tigers as Victor Martinez awaits the 1-2. Skies it to straightaway center. Ender Inciarte is in and under, and an impressive 1-2-3 first for Jaime Garcia.
It's been passed down from generation.
Atlanta Braves Spring Training Baseball is brought to you by Landmark Dodge, Chrysler, Jeep, Ram, and SunTrust.
Well, Jaime Garcia got the Tigers 1-2-3 in the top of the first, and 1-2-3 innings are something Justin Verlander knows a thing or two about, doesn't he?
Yeah, he's one of the best pitchers still in all of baseball. Had a terrific year last year, 16-9, a 304 ERA, 254 strikeouts, 227 innings, and still just a workhorse. 34 starts. He is 34 years old, 6'5", 225.
And it's great to see Ender Inciarte back from his stint on the Venezuela roster for the WBC. Actually got back to camp a couple of days ago, but Brian Snitker gave him a day or two off to reacclimate himself, and rather than make a long bus ride down to the Palm Beaches, gave Ender the opportunity to work out here at Disney and get back in the lineup tonight, and here he is. And he strokes that one to deep right. Perez is on the run, and shy of the track makes the play for the first out. So again, with the WBC, it's been a while for Brian Snitker, Joe, since he's had his probable opening day lineup together, and that's what he features here against Detroit tonight.
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me at all to see this exact lineup when the Braves go to New York and take on the Mets opening day. And it's a balanced lineup, left, right, all the way through, if Brian chooses to use them that way. So he was by the cage today. He was excited about having his guys back and together, and they're going to get a lot of bats this last week.
How concerned was Brian Snitker, or are you, with regards to Dansby missing so much time with the side issue?
So much so that they were really patient making sure they didn't get him back in the lineup and overdo it. If you have heard anything about baseball players and oblique injuries, if you try to come back too soon, it could be a season-long issue, constantly in and out, of the disabled list, and they didn't want to deal with that. So he's healthy. He says he feels great.
Chopper toward Castellanos. Good play, good throw, two outs.
You see Dansby wearing a new number this year, too. Donning his favorite number 7.
Couple of changes on the Braves coaching staff. New third base coach is Ron Washington. Held that role for many years with the Oakland A's. Of course, Ron, the former manager of the Texas Rangers. And Chuck Hernandez, the new pitching coach in 2017 for the Braves. We look forward to talking to them as the spring rolls on. And here's Freddie Freeman. Freddie also back from his stint with Team Canada in the WBC. Those were his numbers last year, but for Freddie Freeman, Joe, it was a tale of two seasons in 2016. Pre-Matt Kemp and post-Matt Kemp.
Exactly. I think if he had known what was coming in the second half, he would have gone to San Diego and escorted Matt to Atlanta.
Monster second half numbers for Freeman. This time, though, he pops it up. Shift was on. Long run, Castellanos. Avila joins him. Can't get there. As the ball drops by the third base coaching box, and Freddie gets a swing on the house. Two balls and a strike. Wind is blowing from left to right. Not sure if the long run for Castellanos was too great a trek.
Yeah, it's about 15 miles an hour blowing in from left field and toward the right field corner, as you said. Too far to go for Castellanos.
Out of play, foul by Freddie. 2-2.
I liked what I heard today by the cage, watching these guys hit, and it was Markakis, Freeman, Kemp, and Flowers. And one of the things that came out of Nick Markakis's mouth watching the other guys hit was fresh hands. This time of spring, some of the guys get a little, pitchers get a little arm weary. Well, the hitters get a little tired as well. But he was talking about how that group did not go to West Palm Beach. They had a day off yesterday. Come back today ready to go. Fresh hands.
But you get to face Verlander.
Yeah.
So pick your poison.
You better be fresh. That's fresh right there.
Missile hit into the seats by Freddie Fowl. But again, 3-2. Well, the pre-Kemp numbers for the Atlanta offense and the post-Kemp numbers for the Atlanta offense were truly startling. I think the one thing we noticed the first 3.5 months of the year was how hard it was for the Braves to score even 3 runs a game on average. That changed after the deadline deal with the Padres. And the man that benefited the most was Freddie Freeman. And with that in mind, it's time for our SunTrust Confidence Starts Here feature. Look at that. 5 runs a game since the 1st of August with Matt Kemp in the lineup.
Yeah, and the first 4 months of the year, they were averaging a little over 3 runs a game. And that improved offense showed in the record.
Saw the Braves go 20-10 in their last 30 games of the season in September and October, and they played teams that were fighting for playoff spots, as you mentioned, including these Tigers. So that's something that gives the team an awful lot more confidence and hope.
It was great to watch. It's excellent baseball. I think that's what has everybody excited, is the infusion of the youth of Dansby Swanson, the experience of Matt Kemp, adding to that a Brandon Phillips at second base.
Mile high pop up. And no play for Avila.
Verlander having a hard time putting Freddie away. So that buzz created by this infusion of players, these veteran players, Kurt Suzuki, I mentioned Phillips, the two veteran starting pitchers, the trade of Jaime Garcia, who's 30 years old. It's reason for everybody to be excited and anxious to see what they can do.
Verlander needs a 10th pitch against Freeman. Popped up left side. Again, Castellanos, long run. Can't get there. That's two of those in this sequence.
Move him over a little closer to the third base line now.
Even Freddie's laughing about it. I think Freddie's locked in.
I would say so. When you can foul off this many pitches from a guy like Justin Verlander. Well, they had the shift right. They just didn't have it high enough. 12th pitch of the at-bat. Fastball, belt high. Yeah, that's one of the few times you might see Justin smile about giving up a homer. That was hard-earned.
Freddie's ready. And the Braves score first here in the first. Freeman's first spring homer. And that'll bring up Matt Kemp. And he skies one to right. That'll be easy for Perez. And that is the inning. The highlight for the Braves, a 12-pitch at bat. Freddie Freeman's homer puts the Braves in front.
Not a bad way to start our first spring telecast, huh?
Garcia, 1-2-3, top of the first, and Freeman with a big league at bat puts the Braves in front.
These were the MVP candidates last season. Chris Bryant won it, of course. Freddie was sixth in the voting, but you got to figure he's going to be right there in speculation for a possible MVP season this year. And gave you a taste of the way he hit in the second half last year right there.
Let's see what Jaime Garcia has in store here in the inning. Mikey Matuk is leading off. He's their center fielder. Okay, this afternoon, this evening.
That's not bad.
And we mentioned Matuk playing center because that's one big question mark for the Tigers as opening day approaches. Who's going to be their opening day center fielder? It won't be Cameron Maben.
who's been moved to the Angels.
And that was something that they talked about in the offseason, that they needed to improve that spot. And they got Matuk from the Rays. Wasn't going to play center field there with Kiermaier there. So they're hoping for good things from this young man.
65 games with the Rays last year, hit a .195, a lot of strikeouts, 68 of them in 185 at bats. That just missed from Garcia. Two balls and a strike. Big part, three balls and a strike for the Tigers center field. Now full count. Remember, it's spring training for the announcers too, as my dad used to say. Nobody on or out, second inning. Late swing. Matuk is still alive.
Flowers today before the game about Jaime Garcia. So give me a scouting report on what you've seen so far. And 5 minutes later, he got through telling me about all his pitches.
Oh, great.
To both sides of the plate and about how much his ball moves and how good he can be. Possibility. And he's going to be a free agent at the end of the year, so he's got a lot of incentive to have a good year.
Matuk walks to start the second. And that'll bring up Alex Avila's second stint with the Detroit Tigers. Well, Garcia is going to be the answer to a very interesting trivia question. Can you remember who the last left-handed pitcher to start for the Braves was?
Oh, man. I do not. I don't know.
Manny Banuelos, September 6th of 2015. 188 games.
No kidding.
Since the Braves have had a lefty take the ball in rotation. That'll be taken care of in game three against the Mets. And a lefty-lefty matchup here with Alex Avila. Whose dad Al is the general manager of the Detroit Tiger Ball Club.
Tell you what, the Braves have some left-handers lined up, though, in the minor leagues that will pitch at this level at some point. Max Fried, Colby Allard, Sean Newcomb, to name just three. There's others.
Double play ball. Phillips to Dansby. That's easy. Two out.
I can't think of anyone else that would be better for Dansby Swanson to play his first full season in the big leagues with him than a guy who's won four gold gloves, Brandon Phillips, who knows how to play the game, knows how to play the game right, and can help Dansby along the way if needed. And that's on top of Ron Washington, who has worked these guys' tails off with basic fundamentals all spring.
Here's Jose Iglesias, terrific shortstop for the Tigers. Late on the Garcia fastball.
This guy's a terrific player. I think known more for his defense when he first came up, but has made himself into a real solid major league hitter.
Well, that glove work last year was extremely impressive. Mentioned Castellanos and the tiny amount of errors he made at third. He made even fewer, did as Iglesias. Just five errors all year.
That's amazing.
And had 64 straight games without an error up the middle for the Tigers. Little number back to the mound. Garcia's got it. And he throws a sinker to first, but Freeman dug it out, and that's the inning. Lead off walk, double play, and a ground out. Braves still up 1-0. Time for a first look at SunTrust Park. Can't wait for opening day and regular season play on April the 14th against the Padres. We'll get our first look at SunTrust Park on the 31st when we televise our exhibition game against the Yankees.
Man, oh man, when that grass went in, it was like, all right, here we go. Lock and load, it's time for baseball. Looks beautiful.
So we can't wait to see you join us in the Braves' new home as Nick Markakis leads off the Braves' second. And he jumps the first pitch and skies it to left. Anthony Gose is there and makes the play, one up, one down.
They understand Nick's dad's been on the DL. Hope he's feeling better. Look forward to seeing him at SunTrust Park. Hope his shoulder's better.
And here's our first look at Brandon Phillips. You mentioned Brandon and his good work defensively. This guy's been a pretty good major league hitter for a long time, too. And you can put him almost anywhere in the lineup for you if you have to. That's another great bit of flexibility for Brian Snitker.
He had a real good second half last year, too. He had 335 after the All-Star break. So he finished with on a high note. And he's coming home.
Out of Stone Mountain, Redan High School. And out of play. Off to our right. Quickly, two strikes. Brandon brings a lot of energy, doesn't he? Big smile on his face. Happy to be a Brave. Good player. And Verlander got him. Swing and miss with the second out. That was vintage Justin Verlander right there. Led the league, American League in strikeouts last year. His first of the night tonight.
Well, he's a big horse. 173 big league wins. 106 losses. He had some injury problems in 15, but bounced back strong last year.
Adonis Garcia with two outs, bases empty, had a good cut, found the back, strike one. Adonis, another player that the Braves were a little concerned about here in the last week or so. He's been bothered by a hamstring issue. But obviously good enough to go tonight.
Told me before the game he felt good. Another guy that they kept out maybe a little longer than normal just to make sure it didn't re-aggravate.
Like the Braves, it was a tale of 2 years for Garcia last year. You might remember. Got off to a tough start at the plate, but even more so with the glove at third base. And as a result, the Braves, you might remember, sent him back to Gwinnett to learn how to play the outfield. Spent, what, 4 or 5 weeks down there playing left field, brought back to the big league club, never played a game in left, went back to third, and then went on a tear with the bat and the glove. Little pop over at first, and that'll be easy for Andrew Romine, and that takes care of the Braves in the second. Skipper Brian Snitker will join us. We're off to the third.
The Jeep.
Freddie Freeman's homer puts the Braves up 1-0. That'll put a smile on a manager's face. And as if on cue, there is the smiling face of the Braves skipper, Brian Snitker. Opening day is about a week or so away. I guess you are chomping at the bit to get going.
Yeah, I think everybody's ready. Hey, we've been here a long time. Guys are in good shape. They're, I think, ready to go. And everybody's just kind of ready for that change of scenery now.
Brian, I know a lot of people have made a lot about the travel that you guys have had to put in this spring. Hopefully most of that's behind you and you can just concentrate on getting your team back and getting them some at-bats here the last week.
Yeah, we got one more trip to St. Lucie on Sunday, and then we go to Lakeland tomorrow. And not bad. I mean, really, for as bad as it's been, it's kind of good now because we are home a lot. We got a couple of three-game homestands that we can back-to-back-to-back a few guys, and getting a couple guys back off some nagging injury type things, and don't want to just push them too far, but you know, we have an opportunity to get some consistent play out of these guys.
Brian, talk if you would about the challenges of this being your first major league spring training as a manager. With the WBC, you haven't had your lineup. You had the injuries that you've talked about. Now it's a sprint to the finish line with opening day just a few days away.
It's been a challenge because, you know, that just putting together rosters to do all this travel is not an easy thing to do. You know, I just kind of lived it and worked it before, but now sitting in the chair and being responsible for it, you know, it's a little harder than what it looks. So because of the travel, you know, you got to be cognizant that some of these guys have already been there and done that, but same time they got to get their work in. But if you look at the at-bats, everybody's got, you know, pretty much the equal amount of at-bats. Everybody's getting plenty in spite of the travel. So guys are getting enough work, and I say it'll be good, I think, now to just get some consistent. You know, you lose the biggest thing in that travel is you lose the routines that you get going with early work and cage work and things like that. It's just these guys getting good places, and then all of a sudden you go 3 out of 4 days on the road, and they get out of their routines.
Brian, I would suspect, too, though, if there's one thing that came out of the World Baseball Classic for you and your staff, would be a chance to see guys like Rio Ruiz, the kid, the outfielder.
Acuna.
Acuna got to see those guys get some at-bats that they might normally not get in spring training.
No, it did, and it gave us an opportunity to play some of our utility guys all around the diamond too, and get them some time in center field when Ender was away. Like you say, Rio's had a really good camp. I mean, the kids really is coming, has really come, and well, that was interesting.
Yeah, I think that ball was punted twice, and they're going to call Dixon Machado out.
Yeah, but anyway, yeah, it did, and you know, watching some of those young guys play was a lot of fun because they're really some talented guys, and we got to run some of the younger guys up here and watch them play, and it was a lot of fun to do that.
Yeah, Brad Ausmus is going to come talk with Jerry Lane about this, Brian. The ball was bunted, and then Machado was out of the box, and the ball hit the bat in fair territory, so he's going to be called out.
Yeah.
And Anthony Gosse will be back at first.
Well, just to be sure, Jerry Lane's been asked to ask Manny Gonzalez.
Would this be a good time, Brian, to get your thoughts on replay?
Yeah, we've had a couple this year that probably would have went to replay. But yeah, I'm learning that also as I do that. So, you know, it's just something we just experience, and you know, you learn the process, and it is what it is. And so the biggest thing, you know, is you just on your toes and replay a lot. So.
Well, they're going to call it a foul ball instead.
Okay.
So if you want to take the headphones off and go crazy out there,
that's all right. No, it's okay. I'm good here.
All right, let's talk about the pitching staff, Brian. Obviously, that was something that John Coppolello worked out long and hard at to improve in the offseason. The Braves had the good run last year, really struggled with the young starters. Tell us about R.A. Dickey, Bartolo Colon, and Jaime Garcia specifically. The first two guys, numbers don't look all that good, but are you satisfied with their progress to this point?
Yeah, you know, they're healthy. It's funny, the other day, R.A. gave up some runs, and Kirk came back in. It's like, I don't know how they hit that thing because it was a really good one. But, you know, it's they've been through the wars before. They know what they're doing. You don't spend the time they do in the major leagues and have the success that those guys have had, not know what you're doing. So I pretty much am happy with where they're at, just like I say, because they're healthy. Jaime's been throwing the ball really well. His health is really good right now. And, you know, you talk about Fulte's had a really good spring also, as well as Julio since he's been back. So I like where we're at. I mean, it's like I say, we got to play the games. I think everybody's excited about opening the new stadium and getting the season started.
I think you just answered my next question, which was this being our first day here to watch the team. There is a definite buzz around the clubhouse, on the field, about the prospects of this team, the potential of this team compared to where this team was a year ago. And the excitement is pretty palatable.
Well, they were excited coming in, because we had a full camp before we had, before we were supposed to. We had our first full squad workout, and it was probably like our fourth or fifth, if you want to get, if you look at it. But it's been a very upbeat camp. Guys are positive. I think we just kind of feed on how we finished last year. That was kind of my main, my point was, I'm getting too old to get better. I want to win. So, I think I like our club. We've stretched the lineup with this, again, especially with the addition of Brandon Phillips and the fact that we have some starting pitching that guys that can cover innings, I think is very encouraging.
With a week or so to go in the spring training portion of the schedule, Brian, what are the decisions that you and your staff have to make before opening day against the Mets?
Well, I think there's a couple of bullpen jobs that are still available, and the bench. I mean, we don't have it locked up right now, and there's still some questions and some discussions to be had, and we have the guys in camp that we're going to use. It's just a matter of which way we're going to go.
On Perez, the batter, with Anthony Gose at first. Perez, the Tigers' right fielder. A lot of discussion, Brian, about a four-man bench. Is that something that's still being discussed?
We're still discussing that. It's just to give the depth in our bullpen. We know, it's kind of, you're just never guaranteed of how much you're going to use those guys, and it's just kind of one of those things where we don't want to lose anybody. We'd like to keep everybody available. It's still something that we're discussing, and it'll probably go down into later on in next week before we decide for sure which way we're going to go.
With the age of a couple of your starters, does that factor into maybe carrying eight guys in the bullpen too?
Yeah,
I mean, don't expect them to go deep in ball games anymore.
Yeah, and that's one of the things, and they are. They're guys that probably aren't going to go seven, eight innings every time. I mean, it's
nice pick by Tyler Flowers, and Ghost gunned out.
But, that's a consideration. It's kind of like, so you have guys that are out of options that teams are looking for pitching. And we saw last year that, it takes a lot of guys to get through a major league season. So we don't really want to lose anybody if we don't have to. But by the same token, we're just, we're going to go with whatever club gives us the best chance to win.
And that really is something that has changed in the way Major League Baseball is played, and I assume managed too, Brian, and that is the use of relief pitchers. We saw it all last year, especially in the World Series between the Indians and the Cubs. Andrew Miller out there 2-3 innings at a time, 4-5-6 guys coming out of the bullpen.
Yeah, and I don't think you can probably sustain that through the course of a 7-month season like we're going to do with those guys, but it's maybe allows you to match up a little earlier in the game, like in the sixth or seventh inning, and use a couple of guys to get through an inning. Like I say, it's always something that, and you see a lot of teams now in the industry, there are a lot of guys are going to the eight-man bullpens, and depending on the starting rotation. So even with the off days, it's something that we're still talking about.
Now to the important question. How are the grandbabies?
Oh, they're awesome. They're awesome. They're call them thunder and lightning now. But it's fun. It's they were down here. We had a lot of fun with them, and they're chopping. They came to the game with Ronnie the other day, and all they chopped the whole time they were here.
Dansby, it's short. Tough hop. Makes a high throw, but that'll take care of the Tigers.
And we would be remiss if we didn't congratulate you, too, on named the manager again, and especially going into SunTrust Park. Way to go. Good luck.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Brian.
All righty.
since 1945.
Freddie Freeman's first inning homer, the only tally so far tonight. Braves are back up against Justin Verlander here in the third with Tyler Flowers, Jaime Garcia, and Ender Inciarte coming up. I love what Brian Snitker said just a minute ago. I'm too old for rebuilding. I want to win.
Yeah.
And a wicked breaking ball from Verlander. Strike one.
Tyler Flowers came to camp in great shape. Looks great. I was looking at some of the numbers on the, for the guys for their year, their numbers for the whole year. And one of them that jumped out at me was Tyler Flowers. 270 average, 8 homers. I didn't realize. I'm sure I knew at the time, but it didn't sink in that he hit 270. Adonis Garcia hit 273 with 14 homers. Their averages were higher than I remember.
And Tyler played what, 83 games, I think it was, and missed 6 weeks with a broken hand. That ball sharply hit down the right field line near the pole, and that'll slice out of play. One ball, two strikes. Tyler Flowers and Kurt Suzuki will be the backstops to start the year for the Braves. And I asked Tyler before the game, does he have a better feel for his pitching staff a year in with the Braves organization? Not just the big league guys, but the minor league guys too. And he said, absolutely. There's a little bit more authority, he said, as this ball is hit toward right center. Was the first out. The pitchers know where he's coming from. He knows where they are coming from. So there's obviously a lot better pitcher catcher comfort for Tyler Flowers at the start of year two in a Braves uniform. We'll see how that plays out. And here's Garcia. It's last week of spring training. The Braves pitchers will probably hit, get them in game shape if possible. And as Brian Snitker mentioned, if the Braves have a four-man bench, some of these pitchers may have to pinch hit at some point.
That's a good point.
And really, when you talk about a four-man bench in the National League with your backup catcher, you might only have three options to hit in a pinch.
Yeah, so don't sit in the dugout in your hush puppies. You might want to be in the dugout with your spikes on just in case.
And definitely don't put milk duds in your back pocket.
No.
That would be a real problem. No balls, two strikes. Garcia.
and off the plate. Love watching Justin Verlander pitch. This guy is state of the art. As you mentioned, terrific career numbers. Over 2,000 strikeouts now. 173 lifetime wins. And ground ball to first. And the flip to first for the second out of the inning. So far, this spring start against the Braves is a repeat of game 162 for Atlanta. The Braves beat him 1-0. That was the Aaron Blair masterpiece on the final day of the season that cost the Tigers a shot at going to the postseason. And Verlander pitched great that day too. His offense just could not handle Aaron Blair's wicked slider at Turner Field.
Braves won 2 out of 3 in that series and pretty much ended the Tigers' hopes.
So here's Ender. He flied out his first time. How many highlight reel catches will Ender Inciarte have for us this year?
A bunch. So happy for him to win the Gold Glove. Richly deserved it.
Lost in the Braves' awful start last year when they began 9-29. Let's not forget Inciarte got hurt. Hamstring. Cost him the first several weeks of the season, and boy, was he missed.
And still scored 85 runs. Stole 16 bases last year, but a lot of that was crimped by the leg injury, the hamstring injury, where they were trying to make sure they didn't endanger that injury coming back. But I look for him to steal at least 20 this year, maybe 25.
Sharply hit. Nice pick. And Verlander is out of the Atlanta third. Top of the order coming up for the Tigers. Jaime Garcia and the Braves lead 1-0.
Well, friends, get your tickets today for an evening with Hank Aaron, a fundraiser in celebration of the unveiling of the Hank Aaron statue and the Hank Aaron Terrace at SunTrust Park Wednesday, March 29th. Go to Braves.com/Hank Aaron for all the details.
This afternoon in the dugout, greeting a lot of the players, and all of a sudden I thought it was Old Timers Day. There was David Justice, followed by Tim Hudson, followed by Steve Avery, all brought in as guest instructors. And you can see how intense David still is and how much he enjoys working with some of the young players. Great to see him.
Jaime Garcia starts his fourth inning and misses low to Andrew Romine. One ball, no strikes. I know in your days with the Dodgers, the Dodger organization had the old Dodgers in camp all the time. How important was that for your development as a young player?
It was, you could easily be awestruck when you would see Sandy Koufax Maury Wills, Pee Wee Reese, those guys coming around, and Roy Campanella always in camp in a wheelchair greeting a lot of guys.
That shook up Romine, fouled it right off his foot. Two balls and a strike.
Ozzie Albies fouled one off his knee a couple of days ago over in West Palm Beach. He was optioned out yesterday to the minor leagues, but the Braves will see him soon. Apparently he's all recovered from his elbow injury last year.
Three balls and a strike. And Romine pops it up. Marcakis is charging, and Brandon Phillips got there with an over-the-shoulder catch. Beautiful play.
If Brandon doesn't catch it, it's going to drop. And that's in that in-between zone that infielders and outfielders hate. Brandon didn't hesitate.
Solid player, boy. What a great addition. Garcia appreciates that effort. One away for Castellanos. Garcia struck him out, his first and only strikeout of the game. Well hit to center. Right at the 400 mark and off the batter's eye. A mammoth home run for Nick Castellanos. Wow.
Was drafted and signed by the Tigers. He came into the draft as rated as one of the best hitters in the draft, maybe the best. And with the wind blowing in from left field, that is gigantic there.
His third homer of the spring. And like Freddie Freeman, Castellanos is ready for the opening bell. He's knocked in 12 runs in his last 14 spring games. So he's healthy and he is a hot hitter. So our game tied at one apiece. And Victor Martinez, the batter, he flying out center, his lone time. Tigers are going to hit some home runs, man. Remember, this is a lineup tonight. Doesn't have Ian Kinsler. It doesn't have Miguel Cabrera.
Or J.D. Martinez.
J.D. Martinez turned an ankle about a week ago or so for the Tigers. And again, that's the last thing Detroit wants to think about, is one of their regular players getting hurt again. That was the problem for so many of these Tiger players in 2016, Martinez included. It's a foot for JD. And a count to Victor Martinez. One ball, now two balls, two strikes.
Yeah, and their rotation has been dinged a little bit too. Mike Fulmer, their rookie of the year pitcher, also sprained an ankle, so he has had his workload cut back a little bit.
Good pitch by Garcia. Martinez didn't get it. And there's the second out. Again, we want to welcome our audience and fans watching on Fox Sports Detroit. Our pals Mario Mpemba and Rod Allen, the terrific broadcasters for the Tigers, have the night off. I'm Chip Carey with my partner Joe Simpson and our Fox Sports South crew from Walt Disney World in Orlando as the Braves and Tigers play tonight. Here's Matuk, who walked and was erased on a double play back in the second.
Well, he's had a good breaking ball tonight. Both strikeouts on breaking pitches.
Nothing appears straight, does it?
Not much, no. Again, a couple of different fastballs, four-seamer, two-seamer, He'll cut the two-seamer a little bit. Try to run it in on right-handers.
And out of play, foul. Like any major league player, certainly any major league pitcher, health is an issue. Garcia started 30 games or more twice in season since 2011. He's had Tommy John surgery already. He's had the thoracic outlet surgery. He's had shoulder problems. But when he's right, Braves saw firsthand last year, he can be overpowering.
Well, and their need for a left-hander in the rotation was glaring, I'll say. And they addressed that and got a good one.
Pitches for Garcia. Number 57 was pulled into the Detroit bullpen. Foul. It again.
Back to that Tigers rotation, though, with Verlander, Fulmer, and then a guy we know real well, Jordan Zimmermann. The Tigers and their fans really didn't see Jordan Zimmermann at his best last year. He battled neck issues all year. Went 9-7 with a high ERA, but hopefully he'll get back on track for them this year.
Foul again. We have Anibal Sanchez, too. We saw him in Detroit a couple of years ago strike out 15 guys in a game.
That's right.
He's been battling some mechanical issues. They're trying to get him right. Encouraging results the last time he pitched.
Well, you got Daniel Norris and a young kid named Boyd, who if Sanchez isn't the fifth guy, fourth or fifth guy, they've got some depth there to pick from.
And again, what a luxury it must be for their staff to know they're going to get four or five runs a game with this offense every night.
Right.
Sharply hit. Good at bat by Matsuk. And the Tigers have a man aboard with two outs in a tie game, and they'll bring up Avila.
Omar Vizquel, the first base coach for the Tigers. A guy that you and I both think ought to be in the Hall of Fame.
Yep.
For National League fans who didn't see him play in Seattle, I will say he was the Ozzie Smith of the American League, if that's a fair comparison.
He was as good as I ever saw play shortstop.
There's that good breaking ball Joe mentioned. Strike one for Avila. Alex back in Detroit. Played with the White Sox last year. He had an injury plagued year. And an odd line in this regard. Played 57 games. Hit 213. Seven home runs. Drove in 11.
I mentioned the need for a left-hander for the Braves rotation. A lot of it has to do with the National League East. When you start thinking about hitters in the lineup on an everyday basis for teams in the NL East, and sometimes you need somebody to kind of offset them, whether it's Duda, Granderson, and the Mets, Murphy, Harper, the Nationals that come to mind right away. There's a lot of solid lefty hitters. Hook.
He's had a good one all night. And Avila is down on strikes. Second strike out of the inning. Third of the game for Garcia. Still. Castellanos with a homer for the Tigers. Freddie Freeman a homer for the Braves. Freddie's coming up second here in the fourth inning as Dansby Swanson takes his second look at Justin Verlander. 2016, a great debut season for Dansby Swanson.
And was one at bat shy of losing his rookie status for this season. So he still is eligible to win the Rookie of the Year award if he has a good season.
Dansby grounded out to third his first time up. And that breaking ball didn't bite. One ball, no strikes. Dansby called up August 17th. Batted eighth, had two hits in that game. His first big league home run came September 6th. Remember, it was an inside the park home run. The second Atlanta Braves player to have an inside the park homer be his first in the big leagues. The other man to do that was Paul Runge, you might remember. And then he hit an outside the park home run the very next game against the Nationals. So Dansby had two homers in back-to-back games last year. Finished with three and 17 RBIs.
Good pitch.
2-2 the count.
One of the reasons talk about the Atlanta bench and the need for versatility. If you're only going to have four guys and one of them's your backup catcher, so you're not likely to use him as a pinch hitter, you need somebody that can play all over the diamond.
Another wicked breaking ball. Dansby thought it might have been low. No argument with Jerry Lane, however. And Verlander has his second strikeout.
So as Brian Snitker was saying, playing guys all over the field looked like a good pitch. The use of Chase d'Arnaud and Jace Peterson at shortstop this spring is not so much that they don't think Dansby was going to play every day. He is. But young players, especially at a physically demanding position like shortstop, it gets to be a grind. You've got to protect those guys and make sure they don't just get worn down to a frazzle and give them a day off here and there. They're in the need for somebody else that can play shortstop.
And the plan that the Braves are employing now certainly wasn't plan A. Plan A was Sean Rodriguez, as that one is gloved by Iglesias in the shift. Pretty play to rob Freddie Freeman. And remember Sean Rodriguez and his family involved in that terrifying automobile accident in Miami. And Sean had to have what we think might be season-ending shoulder surgery.
Yeah, that was what pushed the need to go make the deal for Brandon Phillips, was once they learned of the severity of that shoulder injury for Sean Rodriguez, which was an absolute shame. But thankfully, his family's okay. Survived that wreck.
Verlander set down nine straight after the Freddie Freeman homer. And here is Matt Kemp. This time of spring, when you first telecast or do a game on radio, you get the obligatory, well, he came into camp in the greatest shape of his life, right? You hear that cliche all the time?
Uh-huh.
Might be true with Matt.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that was one of the things he said to me when I first saw him was when I complimented him on being in good shape, and he said, I tried, I worked at it.
Pop fly out of play by Kemp, who had a very big year last year for the Braves and the San Diego Padres. 35 homers, 89 RBIs. I think the Braves would be very happy with that kind of production this year. 35 homer guys in this day and age are awfully hard to find. Verlander Verlander got him to chase a 94-mile-an-hour fastball. He set down 10 in a row, and we're off to the fifth.
This.
A pretty breezy night in Orlando tonight. Good crowd here at Champions Stadium at the Wide World of Sports Complex here at Walt Disney World. This year and next year, the final spring seasons for the Braves here in Central Florida. Braves are apparently moving closer to a new spring training facility down near Port Charlotte and south of Sarasota. That'll be exciting. As Garcia goes to work, this is his fifth inning, and he'll face Jose Iglesias first.
And he's looked sharp.
Jaime went five innings in his last outing. It was a game on one of the minor league fields. Gave up a couple of runs. At 65 pitches. See if he's stretched out and can go six. We'll see. Had a good fastball, 88, 89 miles an hour.
Yeah, he's not going to blow up the radar gun. He is got to hit his spots. He's got to have that breaking ball that we've seen be effective tonight. And work both sides of the plate.
Tricky hop. That ball hit the lip of the grass. And Adonis Garcia stayed with that. Wasn't distracted by the broken barrel of a bat. And there's the first out.
I think that guy is one of the keys going into the start of the season, Adonis Garcia. And I say that because he had never played a full year in the big leagues, and yet he put up big numbers. Can he do it again? And playing on a regular, basically everyday basis, is there a chance that he could even improve on those numbers? But he had 273, 14 homers, drove in 65 runs, despite the time you talked about in Gwinnett.
And that last number is the one that surprised me. If you'd asked me, I would have said low 50s, maybe, in the RBI column.
Yeah, do it again.
Adonis not the only member of the Garcia family for the Major League organization. His brother was signed by the Cardinals. Jose Adolis Garcia is in the St. Louis organization. And now the count to Ghosts, a ball and two strikes.
Into the corner of beauty.
Oh, that was just a great setup. Good sequence there by Jaime with the curveball that froze him, and then a good fastball in the outside corner with some good late movement. Well done.
So Dixon Machado will stand in. Machado flied out in his first and only at bat tonight. Machado's a kid, spent last year with the Toledo Mudhens. That's the Tigers AAA club. Stole, pardon, had 28 doubles, hit 266.
See that patch on their shirt? We'd be remiss if we didn't acknowledge too the passing of their beloved owner, Mike Ilitch, lovingly referred to as Mr. I in Detroit, a community leader and certainly a stalwart in the Detroit area and owner of the Tigers before his passing.
Tough play for Jaime, and it skips right over his glove, and Machado will reach with two outs.
Should be an error on the pitcher. Looks like Garcia was ready to make the play if it got by him.
You cannot call an error at the happiest place on earth. That's an infield hit. So,
really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, you're not going to start on the official scores in our
first game. No, no, I just thinking about how everybody's got to get a trophy.
So Christmas comes early for Machado. Here's Perez. Dansby robbed him in the third inning. And he'll have a chance to do it again. Flip to Phillips, and Garcia is out of fifth inning trouble. Good ball game in Orlando. Glad you're with us.
The Jeep brand.
As we head to the bottom of the fifth inning, we'll take a look at Nick Markakis, who I think, Joe, had an underappreciated season last year, a full year off of his neck surgery, and boy, was he comfortable hitting in the middle of this lineup.
Fourth year in a row with 160 or more hits. Only Jose Altuve has more at-bats than Nick over the last 3 years. Solid in the outfield, former Gold Glove winner himself. And when we were talking about Garcia and his 65 RBIs. How about this? Consider this. Freddie Freeman drove in 91. Kemp drove in 89. Markakis drove in 89. Now, granted, there's nobody in there that drove in 120. You want a guy like that? Sure. You want Miguel Cabrera? Sure. But if you've got three guys in the middle of your lineup that are driving in 90 runs or better.
That ball stroke to right. Nick's retired. Wow.
That's pretty solid. And the thing about Nick, when you're talking about consistent, in those 2 months when the Braves played so well, And Freddie's numbers were really skyrocketing. Kemp was hitting a ton of homers. Well, if anybody was on base, still on base, Nick got him in time and time again. It was uncanny how many RBIs he was driving in at every opportunity.
It's interesting, too, because we mentioned how difficult runs scored were for the Braves in the first 3 months of the year. Let's recall, Nick Markakis batted just about everywhere in the National League lineup, didn't he?
Yes.
And so when Matt Kemp came along, bang, they put him in the fifth spot, and those run-scoring opportunities were there because Freddie Freeman was on base all the time. Matt Kemp was on base all the time. Ender Inciarte was on base all the time.
I've said for a long time, if you know where you're hitting in the order on a nightly basis, it makes a difference because you have similar situations come up virtually every night. And you get used to those at-bats. And when Brian Snitker took over this team, and he talked about this before the game, man, oh, man, he didn't have that set lineup that he could go to every night. And, you know, he had to kind of massage that to try to get guys in the right position to succeed.
Another shot to right. This one off the bat of Brandon Phillips. That should be easy. And it is.
And when Matt Kemp came on board, it's like all the pieces of the puzzle fit together on a nightly basis. Because Inciarte was on fire at the top of the order. Dansby Swanson came along to help in the bottom of the order. But before that, about the only guy Brian could plug in every night was number three, Freddie Freeman. And then it was like, okay, who do I put here and there? And he honestly admitted, he said, I lost more sleep over that, trying to figure out lineups, than I did anything else. And what a difference it is when you have guys you run out there every day in the same place.
And not only do you run them out there, you run them out there and you get five runs a game, which is what the Braves did over those final two plus months.
Right.
So quite obviously the offensive look of this team with the addition of Brandon Phillips makes an already dangerous lineup, as you said, even deeper and perhaps even more dangerous.
And I think the point I was trying to make and didn't make very well is that even if the Braves do have one of their guys go off and drive in 110 or 15 runs, great. But numbers from last year would be adequate too based on what we saw the last 2 months.
1-2 for Adonis Garcia as Verlander is on a major league roll. He set down 12 straight. Braves have one hit. That was Freddie Freeman's homer, a 12 pitch at bat with two outs in the first inning. And Verlander with a 95 mile an hour fastball.
Yeah, and check it out. 58 pitches and 12 open for Freddie and one at bat. 59 now.
Two and two. A little pop toward right. Perez has a chance to tie a record held by many. All three putouts, and Verlander rolling along. 13 up, 13 down, but he's in a tie game.
It's been passed. You know, they had already had guys that could were capable of doing these things. I just came in, fit in, and helped them out a little bit, and we just started rolling as a unit. You know, we're hitting the ball, and was one of the best offenses in the big leagues that second half.
It is contagious, isn't it?
He just seems very comfortable here. Likes his teammates, and they like him. And veteran players especially will tell you they kind of like being the team nobody's talking about or, you know, not watching. Major League East is loaded with Washington and the Mets, both very good teams. The Marlins will be good again. So, and the Phillies are improved as well.
Yeah, it's not going to be an easy division with the pitching that's stacked up. As Romine ground ball to short, Dansby surrounded it, made a good play. There's the first out. We mentioned earlier that the opening of SunTrust Park is right around the corner. I think that's going to be a challenge for the Braves in the first weeks of the season because, like the rest of Major League Baseball, the Braves don't know how their home park is going to play. In many ways, it's a home field disadvantage until they've got a few games under their belt.
Yeah, it won't take long, but I'm really happy that for them that they get to play that exhibition game on the 31st against the Yankees. Kind of get a feel for it.
Here's Castellanos, a majestic solo home run to straightaway center last time up. It was a missile. And we, of course, will be carrying that game against the Yankees here on Fox on March the 31st. Our other televised games from Walt Disney World will come your way Saturday afternoon and Monday night. Got the Mets on Saturday, the Tigers again here Monday. Then the Yankees, and then we'll make our way to New York and open against the Mets. Right back where it came from.
Good hitter.
And what a place to hit if Miguel Cabrera's batting third and he's hitting second.
That's
go get him, kid.
That's a nice spot to be in.
So Castellanos has two of the five Tiger hits. And again, here's Victor Martinez.
That Mets team, obviously loaded with excellent starting pitching, provided they're all healthy again.
To right. Sliding catch by Markakis. On a tough play headed toward the line. Two out.
Good jump by Nick on that. Yeah, the Mets are talking about how, yeah, we've got Harvey and DeGrom and Syndergaard. And hopefully Wheeler. But it's like they've got their fingers crossed on all of them, hoping they're all okay. Steven Matz, hoping they're all going to be okay.
Well, our first look at Jaime Garcia in a Braves uniform was awfully impressive. 80 pitches over 5 2/3 innings, and he allowed just one run. Joe, Jaime Garcia's spring continued in impressive fashion tonight.
I thought he was outstanding tonight. He used all his pitches. He was working both sides of the plate. That curveball was excellent. This was a good setup on the breaking ball there, and then the fastball to the outside corner. I think he's ready to go. Took him out after 80 pitches.
There's Jaime Garcia's line, the home run by Castellanos, the only tally for the Tigers. Now Joel De La Cruz comes on in relief. One thing about the Braves last year, and one reason why, John Coppolella went out and got Jaime Garcia and R.A. Dickey and Bartolo Colon, was the Braves needed some stability in rotation. Last year, the Braves used 22 rookies, 15 of them were pitchers, and 10 of those 15 pitchers made their major league debut on the mound in a Braves uniform, including Joel De La Cruz. And the chopper in between play, Adonis. He made it through a strike to first, dug out by Freddie Freeman. Nice play at the corners. De La Cruz gets the Braves out of the sixth. Bottom part of the order coming up, still tied. Well, fans, we invite you to become an A-list member today and get access to the best seats and lowest prices at SunTrust Park this inaugural season. Go to Braves.com/A-list today.
How about Battery Atlanta? How about not only having a new ballpark to play in, but having a place where you can come early, stay late, take in all that has to offer, the area has to offer? Man, oh, man.
Can't wait.
Something that has not been available to Braves baseball fans in the past.
Tyler Flowers leads off for the Braves here in the sixth inning. Tyler's flied out to right against Verlander. And that pitch well off the mark. Two balls, no strike. As beautiful as the Battery is going to be, as beautiful as SunTrust Park is going to be, perhaps the most exciting news is a much more competitive club is going to be on the field
right
in 2017. Castellanos gave ground and high to first. Romine picked it off, one away. So Jace Peterson's going to bat for De La Cruz. Interesting spring for Jace Peterson in that it appears that Jace's role is beginning to change for Atlanta. With the acquisition of Brandon Phillips, the Braves are trying Jace Peterson all around the diamond to make him sort of a super utility Ben Zobrist type player.
Well, he has not had the best of springs at the plate. maybe that's related somehow with his efforts to try to concentrate on this utility role. Hitting 204 for the spring, 11 hits, 2 doubles, 12 strikeouts. I have to tell you, it's twilight here, and Verlander's dealing. I don't envy Jace Peterson or anybody in a Braves uniform in this inning.
No swing. One ball, two strikes. Verlander's been extremely efficient. 3 strikeouts as he tries to get through inning number 6.
Two different breaking balls. He's got several different breaking balls, but the one that he can start about knee high like that one and drop it in on your shoe tops if you're left-handed. And curve ball to make the right-handed hitters flinch. Does here 3-2.
'94 at the letters.
What a luxury that is, huh? That always was a good pitch to fall back on.
2 quick outs. Verlander looks to be ready for regular season duty. The Tigers will open up the season on the road. 3 games in Chicago against the rebuilding White Sox. Their home opener is Friday, April 7th. They'll have 4 games with the Red Sox. The Twins come in for 3, and then they go to Cleveland April 14th for a 3-game series. And those games with the Indians will probably tell the tale, I would think, right?
Well, they've got to play better against them. If you look at their season last year, 86 wins for the Tigers. They finished 1 game out of the playoffs, and they were 4-14 against Cleveland. So that's one matchup they've got to address.
Ander dumps it over third and has the second Braves hit. So at least moral victory. Verlander's got to go to the stretch with 2 outs. As Inciarte back in the lineup, 1-for-3 in tonight's game.
That looked kind of like a cutter. Kind of like those orange caps.
I was going to ask you.
Yeah, I mean, Detroit with their iconic uniforms and the old English D, they're always so pretty, but they're dark caps, but those are pretty sharp. I know they're spring training caps, but they look good.
Let's see if Ender does some running here, even with 2 outs. Wind really picking up, blowing hard from left to right. That rainy weather all around the Central Florida area most of the day today, including some very heavy scattered thunder showers. Weather though the rest of the weekend, if you're planning on making your way to Central Florida, supposed to be gorgeous. Low 80s and sunny skies, just the way we like it. Good stop by Avila.
It's when you appreciate solid catching skills of a guy. When you got somebody like Verlander who throws so hard, if he misses his target by just a little bit, man, it's hard to flag it down. And he hasn't missed his target too many times tonight. There's that one I was talking about. And a bow locker.
That'll do it. Bela hardly had to move his glove. Pinpoint control for Verlander tonight. 173 lifetime wins for Justin Verlander. He's locked up for the Tigers through the 2020 season. And as you mentioned, a couple of years ago, there had to be some really nervous moments in the Tiger organization when Verlander really was struggling with the win and loss record. He was not the same guy in 2014 and for much of the 2015 season. But he figured some things out in the second half 2 years ago and carried it over last year. And he is buzzing the tower here in the sixth inning. 2-2 the count.
Again, when you can pitch up in the zone like that effectively, as he did to get the strikeout of Jace Peterson. Nice weapon.
Runner goes. Pitch high. Throw to second. Right on the money and in time. And that'll retire the Braves in the sixth inning. We head to the seventh. Pair of home runs. Have this one tied up. Well, fans, your Braves are back. Make sure you join us for opening week Friday, April 14th through Thursday, April 20th, and be part of the opening series in the inaugural season at SunTrust Park. Visit Braves.com/tickets today and get your seats. The Padres will be the first team in, and you'll get your first chance to boo the Nationals at SunTrust Park right after that set with San Diego. Matt Whistler on to pitch, third hurler of the evening for Atlanta. Those were Matt's numbers for the Braves last season.
Inconsistent.
Mm-hmm.
Have a good outing, couple of bad ones. Good outing, couple of bad ones. He has not had a terrific spring. However, most of his work has been in relief, and he got a start the other day against Houston, and he pitched wonderfully. Four innings, one hit, shutout ball, no walks, and had two strikeouts, so maybe that'll get him going.
Let me ask you a question about Aaron Blair, Matt Whistler, and the ripple effect for them with the signings of Dickey and Cologne and the trade for Garcia. Is it fair to say that the Braves are buying time for Matt and Blair and those others that you mentioned in the Braves farm system?
Absolutely. I think the word that was used more often was a bridge. These guys are a bridge to the younger set of pitchers, regardless of what names you want to put in that group. So yes, Matt Whistler has good stuff. He knows how to pitch. He's a smart pitcher. His results weren't good last year, but I believe he would be the first to admit, and I think he did. It wasn't so much mechanical, it was just the inconsistent results, because he wasn't able to locate like he needs to do. he's got a good arm. I heard scouts talking about him tonight before the game about how, you know, he's 91 to 93 on occasion when he's feeling right. Just avoiding those big innings that sometimes plagued him.
Vila took that pitch, even count, 2 balls, 2 strikes.
That 5 ERA from last year, he's way better than that. He's more polished than that.
That missed inside. And while Mike Foltynewicz has been anointed the number 5 starter for the Braves, that means Matt, in all likelihood, will be in Gwinnett. There was some talk briefly in camp about maybe him making the team as a long reliever, but I think that was shot down because the Braves see him as a major league starting pitcher.
And that's my point. He's more polished than a guy with a 5 ERA or some of the struggles he went through last year. And because of that, they do view him more as a big league starter. And think of it this way. He pitched last year and the year before out of necessity. Maybe he wasn't quite ready. Aaron Blair wasn't quite ready last year, but out of necessity, they needed those guys to pitch some innings, and they got beat up at times.
And with the state of pitching in the major leagues nowadays, there are very few, if any, teams that could go through their starting rotation 1 through 5 for a full season. It just does not happen anymore. So I would think that Matt or Aaron Blair or somebody else assigned to Gwinnett be on call, because your time could come most unexpectedly.
Right.
This is Tyler Collins batting for the Tigers. And Whistler's having trouble throwing strikes. Collins' dad, Tom, was one of my dad's favorite players. Missed upstairs again. Miguel Gonzalez is the pinch runner for Detroit. He leads from first with a 2-0 count. It's a 91 mile an hour fastball. Had some movement. Tyler Collins, originally a 6th-round pick in 2011. Split time between AAA and the big league club. Another outfielder getting an extended look for this Detroit ball club. Here we are again, 7-8 days away from rosters being set, and Detroit, as of now, does not yet have an answer for the center field spot.
Rich Doobie, pitching coach for the Tigers now, sitting there next to Brad Ausmus. Doobie was a minor league pitching instructor for the Braves before Chuck Hernandez took that role last year.
Up the middle. Phillips behind the back. What a play! That is going to be fun to watch.
When the Braves made the deal for Brandon Phillips, I immediately contacted some friends of yours and mine in Cincinnati and said, who did we get? What did we get? And the answer was one of the all-time gamers and a guy that the fans love. And I see a play here tonight that makes you realize just why. The fans in Atlanta are going to love the guy from Redan High School.
I mean, Ian Dansby is still talking about that play.
His range is not quite what it used to be, but he still catches what he can get to.
And you mentioned the influence that he's going to have on Dansby Swanson. Let's not forget Ron Washington and his influence, your former teammate in the minor leagues, who is as tireless as
as tireless an instructor as there is in the big leagues.
And he won't settle for anything less than your best.
Back to the mound. Whistler got some defensive help, but he helped himself. A great double play started by Brandon Phillips sends us to the stretch.
There comes a point in life when you start to expect.
Game be strong up the middle. The Braves have been that tonight.
Take a look at the Braves new second baseman. Started a double play, great catch on a tweener in the outfield, and then just moments ago was behind the back flip to Dansby Swanson.
So Brandon Phillips with a nice debut game for our television audience tonight. As this ball game moves to the home seventh, still tied at one. Mark Lowe, the new pitcher for the Tigers. Dansby Swanson was in the box when Inciarte was thrown out trying to steal a moment ago. And a broken bat pop-up has Dansby down a strike. Wholesale changes for the Tigers. We'll get to those as we get them. As you see, the numbers for Mark Lowe, 7.11 ERA. And that's right there quickly, two strikes.
Great night for Verlander. Six innings, two hits, one run. That was on the homer by Freeman in the first. Did not walk a batter. Struck out four.
Still 0-2. Dansby tonight has grounded out and has struck out looking. But does not look to be swinging the bat with any kind of problem after that side issue. That's the best news of all. 0-2. And way upstairs, 1-2 now. Mark Lowe lives in Vancouver, Washington. Tigers signed him as a free agent before the 2016 season. Broken bat again. And Dansby out by a step or two at first base. And that's how the home seventh starts.
Nice play by Machado.
Other changes for the Tigers. Dominic Ficicello is the third baseman. I'll give you time to write that one down. That might take
a minute. I'm going to have to do it phonetically.
Efren Navarro is their first baseman. Alex Presley is in left. Collins is in center. And of course, Mark Lowe, the man on the mound. Freddie Freeman's the lone man to touch the plate tonight for the Braves. A great matchup with Justin Verlander in the very first inning. Two outs, bases empty, and Freeman just kept fouling off pitch after pitch. A couple of pop-ups were windblown down the third base line. The Tigers in the shift couldn't catch two of them. And then Freddie unloaded with a long homer down the right field line for the Braves' only score against Verlander. And it just continues a sizzling spring for Freddie Freeman, who came in hitting, and yes, it's spring training, but was still hitting 464 at the start of play tonight.
Yeah, I know that we always temper those numbers sometimes, 464. But I don't care if it's spring training or not. You'd much rather be hitting 464 than 154, no matter what time of year it is.
Hard hit, sinking line drive to right. And Freddie's got a second hit.
Had a lot of top spin.
And that'll be the end of the night for the Braves first baseman. Matt Tuiasosopo is going to check in.
Top hand came up over the top of the baseball, imparted the top spin and caused it to sink sharply in front of the right fielder.
So one on, one out. Matt Kemp. Matt's flat out, and he has struck out. Been around a while. Originally drafted by the Mariners back in 2004, has had to battle injuries throughout his big league career, especially in his days with the Mariners. Right hand problems, shoulder, elbow strain, elbow surgery. Then went to Texas for a couple of years. He was hurt there. Intercostal muscle and back issues. 2013, spent some time with the Angels. They signed him as a minor league free agent. Had a neck problem with the Halos. 2015 was with Seattle and Toronto, and last year with the Tigers, 54 games, a 7.11 ERA, 57 hits, 21 walks in 49 and a third innings.
You know, and those are rotten numbers, but you got to hand it to him for sticking with it with all those injuries. Perseverance says something about his character. They must like his stuff, or they wouldn't be giving him an extended look this year.
One ball, two strikes for Matt Kemp, and he hits a high fly ball toward left near the track, to the wall, and at the fence. Alex Presley hauls it in. The wind's blowing the other way. That's out by the batting cages. No such luck for Kemp. Two outs.
Well, Matt hit one off the batting cages in batting practice, turned the wind around, and almost did it there. Nice play by Presley. We've seen him before, I think, with the Pirates.
So a long, loud out for Lowe.
Brings up Nick Markakis.
During this entire half inning, Justin Verlander continued to throw in the Tiger bullpen. He was getting a few extra pitches in, maybe working on something after he threw his six innings tonight.
He didn't throw many pitches, so maybe he, from a conditioning standpoint, wanted to stretch it out.
Our crew has him at 88 pitches over those six innings. And that's one thing you love about Justin Verlander. He likes to finish what he starts. One ball, one strike for Nick Markakis. He's fly to left and hit one right on the button, but was out to the right fielder. Little tapper. Lowe can't handle it. And all hands are safe. Little comebacker popped out of the leather of Lowe. Tuiasosopo stops at second. Braves are still alive for Brandon Phillips with two out.
That was the 40th at bat for Nick Markakis. He's been able to go to the post every time Ryan Snitker's asked him. He was not on the U.S. team for the World Baseball Classic. Six RBIs this spring, so he's gotten his work in and will retire for the night.
Here's Phillips. And Brandon takes downstairs. Phillips struck out. Rio Ruiz hopes to hit next. Sean Kazmar, by the way, is the pinch runner for Markakis. If you're just joining us, shame on you, first of all. Secondly, missed two excellent pitching performances. Jaime Garcia for the Braves looked very crisp over his 5 2/3 innings. He struck out four, walked one, gave up one run at the Castellanos home run. Justin Verlander equally sharp, six innings for him. Roller to third to take care of Phillips and the Braves. Lowe out of seventh inning trouble. Our tie game heads to the eighth.
I'll pick you up at
It's a treat to watch Justin Verlander work, and he is ready for the season opener for the Tigers against the Chicago White Sox. Six terrific innings for him tonight. MLB.tv Premium is back and better than ever. Watch every out-of-market regular season game live on over 400 supported devices. Plus, get a free subscription to At-Bat Premium, the number one app for live baseball. Blackout and other restrictions apply. Go to MLB.tv for details. Fourth pitcher for Atlanta tonight is Aroldis Vizcaíno.
He's having a good spring, folks. While some of his cohorts in the bullpen, the young flamethrowers, are having trouble throwing strikes, that's not the case for Vizcaíno. This is his eighth outing. He's walked two, struck out 10, and only given up one run.
Up the middle, one pitch, one out. That'll work. Machado's retired. He's one for three. And here's Juan Perez.
And you see Jace Peterson at shortstop, again, getting extra work there in case he's needed anywhere on the diamond.
Perez 0 for 2 tonight. Eighth inning ball game. As we look at the pen on paper, how do you like the composition of the Braves relief corps?
I like the way you did that.
Well, just making sure you're
pen on paper. Nice.
What do you think of the relief corps as it stands, or as we suspect it'll stand?
I think it has a chance to be really good. Jim Johnson was lights out like everybody else in the last 2 months of the season. At the end of the game, Vizcaíno had some health issues, as you recall, that kind of pumped up his numbers. He was the closer for the team early in the season, but after he got hurt, he had a little bit of a hard time. They've got great arms. There's a couple of guys, Jose Ramirez, Miguel Cabrera, who have been throwing, have been walking too many guys. And if they can start throwing more strikes here in the last week, I like that a lot better, and so will Brian Snitker.
One of the better stories, I suppose, from what I've been able to read from Mark Bowman and Dave O'Brien, has been Eric O'Flaherty this spring. And Eric, apparently, after all those years of arm troubles, has not only rediscovered his sinker again, but he's picked up a mile or two mm-hmm. with his fastball.
Yeah, that's a great sign.
And he and Blaine Boyer, who you might recall was one of the baby Braves back in 2005, those guys have made a crowded Braves bullpen even more so, and that's a good thing.
It's Mauricio Cabrera. We're playing the Tigers, so I got Miguel Cabrera on the brain. My apologies to Mauricio. But that's why I say it's got a chance to be dynamic. A, because they got some flamethrowers down there. They've got a mix of youth and experience with guys like O'Flaherty, Ian Kroll, Josh Colemanter. Could do some real good matchup issues with different teams with so many guys down there. But throw strikes, those young guys. Doesn't matter how hard you're throwing if you're not throwing strikes.
This is Efren Navarro, the Tiger first baseman, getting his first at bat of the game. He's kind of efficient so far in his inning of relief tonight.
Josh Colemanter, picked up by the Braves last year, pitched really well in, I think it was three starts, went 2-0. And he right now figures to be that long man you're talking about. Instead of having a young pitcher like Matt Whistler have that job, Josh Colemanter, who could start if you need him to, is really well suited for that.
Fouled away by Navarro. He was signed by the Tigers this January as a minor league free agent. Spent some time with Mariners and Cardinals organizations last year. 7 and at the letters. Strike after strike from Aroldis Vizcaino as the Braves come up in the 8th, tied up.
Atlanta Braves Spring Training Baseball is brought to you by Landmark Dodge, Chrysler, Jeep, Ram, and SunTrust.
Chip and Joe with you for the first time in Orlando. Bottom of the 8th inning, Rio Ruiz is going to lead off against Bruce Rondon, a hard-throwing right-handed relief pitcher.
Good numbers last year. 2.97 ERA. Low average against. Better than a strikeout per inning pitched. And he can bring it.
Rio late on that fastball in the mid 90s. Rio Ruiz has had himself a nice spring camp.
He's another guy that came to camp in shape, Chip, with intentions of trying to make the club. 292 average, two doubles and a homer. But a very much slimmed down Rio Ruiz.
If memory serves, didn't he have that weird sequence? He was set to make his major league debut last year in a driving rainstorm, and the game got stopped, and he never got to bat. I believe that was against Washington. I may be wrong about against whom it was, but he stood the box.
Right.
Dad came to see him play, and the game was canceled for all intents and purposes and didn't get a chance to hit for several days after that, as he didn't get a high slider, and Rondon has his first strikeout. Here's Blake Lally. Rio's a player who has made himself a little more than a prospect with this camp. Should something happen, I think the Braves would feel pretty good about bringing him up.
And Ron Washington was singing his praises today, too, about his work defensively.
This is Blake Lally, his first at bat of the game.
I wish everybody had the opportunity, if they were having a bad day, just go sit in the dugout next to Ron Washington for about 5 minutes. That's all it would take. Get on with your day and you'd feel a whole lot better.
I guess it's too early to say that Lally popped that one foul, so I won't.
Well, pen to paper already. I mean, you're breaking out some of your A material.
That was
like so many, a total accident. However, one ball and one strike. Blake saw some time, brief time with the Braves last year. Hit a .154.
In the air toward third. Now you can use it.
Nah. Once was it. Hasn't the audience suffered enough? Cello makes the play for the second out.
Cello.
And Jace Peterson, the batter. Jim Johnson's up and throwing. The Chief getting ready in the Braves pen. Jim will have the 2, 3, and 4 hitters in the Detroit ninth. Now, if this game stays tied after 9, would we play a 10th inning? And if so, what were your thoughts on the idea of putting a runner at second base in extra innings to try to speed the game along?
Answer to question number one. It depends on the Tigers and how many pitchers they brought with them on the trip over from Lakeland.
I think I know the answer to number two.
And number two, you don't want to know. There are so many things wrong with that. How would you like to be a guy, say, in extra innings, and let's say Jim Johnson comes in out of the bullpen, and there's a runner at second on the road, and the home team wins. They drive in that run, and they win the game. Jim Johnson get the loss?
Or is it a team loss? I don't know. Yeah.
Not his run. Is it going his ERA?
Right.
I'm with you. There's so many things wrong with that.
It's too early to get into that, but I don't know. I don't know if they would do that in a game like this. I mean, if you're going to experiment with those kinds of pace of game situations, why not do it in a spring game? But hopefully it won't come to that. So the Braves can push across a run here with 2 outs, or perhaps in the ninth.
A little bit of a quick pitch there from Rondon. Jason's ready.
We will be seeing the end of the intentional walk.
Yeah, I'm okay with that one.
Are you?
Yeah.
I forgot to ask Brian Snitker when we had him on for our interview what his sign would be to signal for the intentional walk. As Peterson out by an eyelash at first base, Rondon just beat him to the bag. 8 complete, still tied.
another first look at beautiful SunTrust Park. Opening day right around the corner. We're excited as can be about the Battery. A chance for us to interact with fans before and after the game. Come early, stay late, watch a Braves game, and check it all out. SunTrust Park, truly a new chapter in the history of Atlanta Braves baseball.
I like the way they're going to display all of the pennants that we're used to seeing on the 755 Club railing at Turner Field. They're going to put them on the light standard out in right field. I think that's going to have a real good look.
And I know how excited you are to see lights in the outfield.
Oh, my gosh. Are you kidding me? Think how good Endurance Yard is going to be now. He'll be able to see the ball.
Well, hitters didn't have a chance to see the ball much against this guy late last year, did they?
No, he was outstanding. He was like the hitters in the last 2 months of the season. He was on fire. I think he only had one blown save from August 1 on.
So face Dominic Ficuccello to start things off in the night.
You were talking about the bullpen. It all begins with the closer. You got to have a guy at the end, and then you start working back toward the starter to fill in those spots. And who's going to be the setup guys? Usually need a lefty or two down there to give us some balance, especially in the National League East. And the Braves have those, and they have candidates for that, and Ian Kroll and Eric O'Flaherty, among others.
Jim's had an excellent spring. He's allowed just two hits. He has not given up an earned run in any of his first six appearances. And for a veteran guy like Johnson, and I would assume for Bartolo Colon and R.A. Dickey, also veteran players, you don't worry at all about... Let me take that back. You don't worry as much, perhaps, about the numbers as how they feel and what they're doing to get ready for their first term.
I agree. You are concerned more with how do you feel, get your work in, what can we do to help you get your work in, how much do you want, and stay healthy.
And I would assume of those two, in the case of R.A. and Bartolo, that gauging exactly what R.A. Dickey's results are is almost impossible because he's throwing a trick pitch.
Yeah.
A knuckleball.
Well, and if Kurt Suzuki's saying, I don't know how they're hitting it, that tells you how much it was moving.
Good start for Johnson. A strikeout takes care of Ficuccello. And now John Hicks will be the hitter. One game. Home runs from Castellanos and Freddie Freeman. Turbo sinker. And that's what had hitters off balance for Johnson last year.
Brian Snitker and Chuck Hernandez got to be very pleased tonight with what they've seen from their staff.
Jaime Garcia, 5 2/3 innings, a 5-hit, 1-run ball. Joel De La Cruz retired the only batter he faced. Matt Whistler, a scoreless inning. Rodis Vizcaino, a scoreless frame. Now Jim Johnson. As the Braves try to break through for the first time this spring against the Tigers. No balls, two strikes. Braves will have the top of the order in the ninth. Yank foul again. Great to have our Fox Sports crew with us here in Orlando. Brian Woodrum, our producer, Mike Miller, our director, Arbuckle Jenkins, our statistician.
I was surprised to learn that none of them have been working all winter either.
Really?
Yeah. Didn't know that. Took a lot of time off, went to Patagonia together. I didn't know that.
Swing and a miss. Two outs. We've had a role change for the dominatrix of trivia.
Gretchen Caney is our AD tonight. So I'm not sure if we're going to even have a trivia question during our regular season broadcast. What would you call it? Splendid finish that you, Tom, and I had.
Splendid's a good call.
Yeah.
I was just curious, is that attention deficit? Is that what AD?
Alex Presley is in the box with two outs. And he takes a little low. Tigers are going to have a very good team. They should have a good season. Of course, if they can stay healthy, they've got Miguel Cabrera and a whole lot more. Terrific pitching, excellent bullpen. And a base hit by Presley the other way with two outs.
He's a nice little player. I've always liked him. He's tough out. He's a good outfielder. He can play either one of the corner outfield spots. I think he could probably play center just fine also. And my recollection of him is that he always gives you a tough at bat.
I would guess the next progression would be, and the logical question, can he do it every day?
Well, I'd say if he could, he wouldn't be changing teams quite so often. But he's a good fourth or fifth outfielder for any club, I would guess.
Miguel Gonzalez, the batter with two outs. Presley's got a pretty good lead. Gonzalez take an extra moment. I like the Tigers team. I think obviously the Indians are the team to beat in the Central. Made it to game seven of the World Series before falling to the Cubs. The Indians though begin the season without Jason Kipnis, who's had some injury problems. He'll be out 4 or 5 weeks. Cody Anderson, arm trouble, he's done for the year.
Yeah, but they're going to get some of those guys back that were ailing at the end of the year, like Danny Salazar. They'll have him back in the rotation.
They'll get Michael Brantley back, terrific player. Mm-hmm.
And they signed Edwin Encarnacion.
That's the biggie.
Yep.
But as you said, and rightfully so, how different might the Tigers' season have gone last year if they hadn't gone 4-14 against the team that won the division?
Yep.
Two balls, no strikes. Runner goes. Little dribbler left side. Rio. Got him by a step. Good play. So Jim Johnson keeps up the good work by the Atlanta staff tonight. We'll see if the Braves can win it in the home ninth.
Atlanta Braves Spring Training Baseball is brought to you by Yellowwood and GMC. This is your business. Spring Telecast is presented by authority of the Atlanta Braves and may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form. And the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without the express written consent of the Atlanta Braves.
To the fateful ninth we go as Daniel Stumpf, a former Philadelphia Philly, takes the ball for the Detroit Tigers.
Rule 5 draft by the Tigers. So they're hoping to catch lightning in a bottle here.
And he'll face Mel Rojas Jr., who leads things off. We are told that in between innings, Brad Ausmus looked over at Brian Snitker in the Braves dugout and flashed the old 10 fingers sign, meaning if the Braves don't break through and win this game in the ninth, that they would play another one. We are at the time of spring where, as you said, both managers are taking extra looks. How many pitchers do they have? What situations work? What don't? Let's see if Rojas and company can make it academic. Way high. Quick turnaround for both these clubs. The Braves will face Detroit tomorrow in Lakeland. And Julio Teheran's going to pitch for the Braves. Matthew Boyd is going for the Tigers. Of course, Julio's already been named the Braves' opening day starter. We head to New York to take on the Mets.
How far is it to Lakeland from here?
In miles or hours?
45 minutes. That's the closest road trip the Braves have right now.
Right. That's why the new spring training site for Atlanta is going to be so vitally important. If you're not familiar with the Central Florida roads, I-4 is the main artery that connects the coasts, and it's being rebuilt. That's headed for the corner. Rojas around first is going to try for two. He's going to make it with a belly flop slide. There's an excellent ninth inning start. Good at bat.
Put a good swing on this. Pitch biting in on him. Down and got it, and winning run at second base. Nobody out.
For a familiar face, Emilio Bonifacio. See how the Braves play it here with nobody out. But again, the point is I-4 in Orlando, from north of Orlando almost down to the Disney area, is under construction. So traffic, which is already difficult here, is especially so. Bunted off the plate, foul. As was explained to me a couple of years ago, the traffic in Orlando at Disney is like the Super Bowl dumping onto I-4 every day.
Yeah, you just can't get there from
you
here.
You can't get anywhere. So that's why there have been so many games already between the Braves and Tigers. This is the fifth of the spring. Number six comes tomorrow. There will be a seventh on the 27th, which will also be televised by our group. Mike Fultonevich will get the ball in that game. So that'll be fun. Mike's had an excellent spring.
Sure has.
So has Emilio. He's another versatile guy. In his younger days, he could play the infield and the outfield for you. Not so much anymore, but a versatile guy who can pinch run, steal a base.
He played third base for part of a game a few days ago.
Almost hit him. Two balls and a strike.
I mean, he's an odds-on guy to make the club in a backup role, because there aren't any other outfielders really in contention, and they need at least one.
Ronald Acuna, who had a terrific spring in the early days of camp, isn't ready yet. Dustin Peterson got hurt.
Yeah, it was really a shame.
Broke the hamate bone. Nobody covered third. Throw to first. Perfect sacrifice bunt for Bonifacio and a winning run 90 feet away.
That was bad communication there. Whatever they had set up, third baseman typically will let the pitcher know if he's going to cover the bunt. Instead, the pitcher cut him off and nobody to throw to at third base.
So Matt Tuiasosopo will have a chance to be the hero. The Tigers will bring the infield in. See if Atlanta can walk off with the win.
He leads the team in homers this spring with three. Hit two in one game. I think he hit them all in consecutive at bats over a two game span.
There you go. Somebody was parking at Jerry Lane. They said, I didn't hear you. So after the 2-0 count, they just waved Tuiasosopo to first. That sets up the double play. First and third. Winning run still 90 feet away. Now Ron Washington will have a chat with Adam Walker, who grabs a bat. Now, Brad Ausmus will strategize. Next Friday, March 31st at 5:30 Eastern, get your first look at SunTrust Park with a special edition of Braves Live, Welcome Home. Then at 7:30, you won't miss this. The Braves take the field at SunTrust Park for the first time against Joe Girardi's New York Yankees. All the fun begins at 5:30 next Friday, only on Fox Sports South and Fox Sports Go.
Skid Walker's the one the Braves claimed on waivers, I believe. And he'd been bouncing around from team to team on waivers because he's got a ton of power. You see a couple of homers this spring already. It's hard to find power these days, and he's got a lot of it.
Right in there for a strike.
Routine fly ball would go over the head of any of the outfielders they have to play in.
There for a strike, one and two.
Walker appeared to kind of jam himself as he stepped into that.
Off his knuckles to the right side again.
Strong young man.
Up the middle, and the Braves have won it. Adam Walker chases home Mel Rojas Jr., and the Braves have beaten the Tigers in their last at bat. Final score 2-1.
Terrific Atlanta pitching as the Braves outlast Justin Verlander and the Detroit Tigers bullpen tonight. That was a fun game.
Had a lot of exciting defensive plays. Get a walk-off win in our first broadcast of the year. Nice job by all the guys there in the ninth inning.
So Jim Johnson, the winner in relief, Adam Walker walks off a 2-1 Braves victory.
It's the match.